The Reverend and the Rabbi, Faith and Eggs. Reverend Bill Crawford, Senior Pastor of Larchmont Avenue Church, and Rabbi Jeff Sirkman, Senior Rabbi of Larchmont Temple, are friends and colleagues in our community who get together regularly for breakfast and always lively discussion. Join the Reverend Bill and Rabbi Jeff at their latest meal at the Nautilus Diner. Enjoy a breakfast of faith and eggs with the Reverend and the Rabbi.
Look at you. You look like sunshine,
it's
brother.
Summer dressed
really?
Down. It's summer dressed down.
Really?
Thank you very much.
Hot time,
here at the
summer
diner.
In the city.
It's
back
time.
Of my
Come
neck
on.
Is dirt and gritty. Good morning, sunshine.
Good
look at you. Look
good
at
morning,
you.
Sunshine.
Really, it's a brilliant shirt.
You know what? I'm just trying to get the beauty of summer here.
Yeah.
What are we? 1 day, 2 days into summer? 2 days.
June 21st would
so
be.
So today's the 23rd.
The longest day and the equinox. And now, oh my gosh, get a grip. The days get shorter.
You see? So we're starting on a down note.
Oh my gosh.
Down note.
And now the days are short.
The light
we're
is diminishing.
We're not in the autumn of our years.
Little by little.
Oh my gosh. Oh gosh. I'm sorry.
Oh my
okay,
goodness.
Okay, can we roll that back?
Oh my goodness. Anyway,
yeah. It's wonderful to see you.
Great to see you. Great to see you. You look great.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. You got a haircut special for today?
Really?
Yeah.
You got a certain glow about you. You look kind of radiant and rested.
I'm telling you, that's all. Yeah, I got a good night's sleep. The Red Sox have not been playing well.
Uh-huh.
And my son got me for a pre-Father's Day gift, the MLB package, so I can watch every single baseball game that's on TV in Major League Baseball.
That is a true fan.
But I just watch one team.
And
they've lost, like, I don't know, 5 out of the last 8 games. They just all of a sudden on this little slide, and I'm thinking, oh, my God, the Red Sox are back. Here we go.
Yeah.
You know, so it's been tough, Chicago White Sox. I feel like I am back home.
Uh-huh.
As I'm watching Fenway Park.
You know, I mean, it is a homecoming. It's a spiritual thing.
It is a homecoming. Think about the goal of baseball. The goal of baseball is to go out into the field of life and to eventually come back home.
Come back home. The goal of baseball.
Homecoming.
There
baseball
we go.
Baseball is home, a home run.
There we go. Home run.
It's a home
run.
It's to come to
and
home
there's no,
base.
And, you know, time clock. You know, Bart Giamatti says
the great,
no time clock.
No.
I mean, it's not like okay, first period, second period, third period,
no.
Fourth period, Golden State Warriors looking edgy. Okay, that's another story.
Yeah.
But you know, none of that with baseball.
Nope.
None of that with baseball.
Baseball is the field of
take your time coming around.
The field
coming
of dreams.
The home.
That field of dreams.
Yeah.
That's right. Time goes out the window.
Yeah.
And you're able to connect with generations past.
Yeah.
Certainly with generations present and future. It's an awesome thing.
Truly,
it
truly,
is.
Truly.
I didn't even order.
Oh, my gosh. Look at this. It's telepathy.
Ice coffee.
Thank you, sir.
Ice coffee for guess who?
If you have any half and half or half and half, as I would say, that'd be great.
Would you like a little coffee with your half and half?
Yes, I would. Ba-da-bum.
Ba-da-bum. Thank you so much. Caesar. Hail Caesar. Indeed. Oh, my gosh. A little pause here as we caffeinate.
So tell me, first of all, most important thing, how are you? How's your family?
I am well. Pause. There are moving parts. Making our steps into the summertime.
Yes.
My wife Julie has concluded her academic year teaching in and commuting back from Ohio, Columbus at Trinity Seminary. She just concluded a one-week stint at the Yale Divinity School, where she taught a summer course there, and that's been good.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah, we've never had napkins
like this.
We've
never had
like
napkins.
Why is that?
We have additional napkins.
Why is that?
I think it's
a napkin tower.
Maybe it's an ice coffee.
Yeah, and then the glass there, I guess.
But you never waste napkins.
Yeah,
you never waste napkins.
Why would you do that?
Who knows?
Would
you do that? You never know.
Yeah.
You just never know.
Is it a sign, Rabbi?
It could be. We can order. Yeah.
This is historic. Cesar, I couldn't help but notice we have two, but
I am half and half. This is regular milk.
There we go. Why should
now
I question?
This. Just watch this.
Why should I question? Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Okay, which one is the half and half? Okay. All righty. Moving right along. Okay.
What are you having?
I would love to have two eggs poached. Okay. In a small dish cup. And home fries and rye toast. Yeah, no juice.
Sister, may I get lox with cream cheese inside an omelet? Okay. Well done. No potatoes, no toast. I'll have a bite of his.
There you go. There you go. Okay. There you go. Thank you, Caesar.
So you tell me about your family.
So yeah, so you know, Julie is back in the house.
But are you all divinity seminar, or she was teaching?
She's she was teaching a course, Bible and the Arts, actually, and she has Julie Faith Parker. Shout out to Julie. She's got the PhD in Hebrew Scripture, but she also. Because she studied up there in New Haven and did some further stuff back in time on this. She's got docent status at the Peabody Museum.
Oh, my gosh.
So, you know, Dr. Parker calls up. She's teaching this course. And they say, well, you know, you can handle this. We don't need to have our staff there for that.
Right.
So she's walking amid the artifacts, you know, the hieroglyphics, you know, the Akkadian, you know, the kind of the relics that... kind of reflect some of what even might be Dead Sea Scroll jar and the like. And so it was a one-week course basically for clergy folk,
great.
Who come from near and far.
I'm sure.
You know, California.
If I know about it, why not?
Yeah. You know. So that's Julie. And then Graham is working here in town at Estelle's, the cafe, as well as a computer graphic internship in the city.
That's great.
Yeah.
I saw Graham at the corner. Uh-huh. And I was about to cross against the light.
Yeah.
And all he said to me was, that was basically it. And I thought, there you go.
He cares.
He cares. Well, he cares deeply.
We want our rabbi safe.
Well, you've raised children to do the right thing.
Yeah. Well, there we go.
So, yeah.
And then Mari, because we want to get to your family here, but Mari is finishing up a year with AmeriCorps in New Orleans. The Big Easy. She's working hard at a charter school in the city.
And she was doing some drama down there as well.
She's working hard during the week at the school with these high school kids and some quotable quotes from these, you know, 15, 16-year-olds that she's working closely with. But also, she did a walk-on moment at the Comedy Club, the New Orleans Comedy Theater.
Oh, my gosh.
And one thing led to another. And she has a summer gig every Saturday night. She's part of the improv group at the New Orleans Comedy Theater. You can click on the website and see Mari Crawford.
Of course she is.
And so she's got game. She's going to finish up at the end of July. I will fly down, and she and I will have a road trip. Birmingham, Alabama on the way back, Civil Rights Museum, Atlanta, the MLK Museum, some friends there, our nephew, her cousin in Charlotte. And then we're going to swing back north, along the Skyline Drive in Virginia.
Oh, my God.
Blue Ridge Mountains, West Virginia, you know.
This is hit number two from there Reverend we go. Bill.
My beloved daughter and dad, we're going to have like
a
4-day road trip. We're looking forward
thing.
To it. Yeah, that's us. Wonderful. So how about you, my dear friend?
Yeah, I have no idea.
You have no idea, but we got...
They're all good.
Well, let's start with Sophie. Let's start with youngest
Sophie
to go forward.
Sophie is doing okay.
And a cute puppy. You've got a cute puppy.
We have an old puppy. Bella's almost 15 years old.
Uh-huh.
15
uh-huh.
in July. Uh-huh. Sophie's doing okay. She's working with that Down syndrome and autistic, you know, kids, 7th, 8th graders
she
in New Rochelle.
She has great
patience and just the ability, that gift that Susan and Remember Before Blessing had. And she just has the skill. She's going to do a summer camp of the same thing.
Awesome.
Her sweet boyfriend Tyler is home and working at the Anne Frank Museum, actually.
It's
called the Anne Frank. He's doing a great internship there. He sort of has a minor in Holocaust studies as a history major at Binghamton.
No kidding.
And he has such a deep interest, and he knows so much. He's just so committed to sort of the values that grow out of, fighting intolerance. And so he's doing that, and there's a new name to it, the Anne Frank Center for Mutual Respect, and they're trying to rebrand themselves.
And it's in New York City.
In New York City,
yeah.
It's been a great experience.
Yeah.
You know, Gabriel and Chelsea, Gabe's, they're coming up
July
4th weekend. to hang out with the old guy.
Now, when's their anniversary?
Their anniversary is
it's a summertime. It's a summertime thing.
It's August something.
Gabe,
August
Chelsea,
20...
turn the volume down right now.
No,
we're going to work this out.
If anybody knows, it's like August 23rd, 22nd.
Okay, ours is
something like that. Wow. It's the end of August. I know that. I know that.
I have a feeling that we're going to find out real soon. It might not be on air.
Yeah, no. I'm in big trouble here. I know it's the end of August. Please. Today, June 23rd, is my mother-in-law's birthday, which is great. She is, she likes, say.
What's her name?
Leona Paul.
Leona Paul.
Susan's mom, Leona. Yeah. My mother, Allah Shalom, Leona. Wow. We had two Leonas.
Oh, wow. Really?
Yeah, interestingly. But,
how about that?
Yeah, and Leona Paul is a great lady. Uh-huh. Loves her 16 grandchildren.
Any relation to Les Paul, the famous guitarist?
Not even this close.
Okay,
no,
okay. So just thought I'd try that.
No, it's a good time. Okay. No. Yeah. But Gabe and Chelsea are coming up. Gabe is just finishing his postdoc, doing great, trying to apply for a job, get a license. The licensure exam, passed that in Florida.
Now, where would... Okay, in Florida. Then you.
Yeah,
you
they live in Miami.
So because Chelsea's
Miami.
An attorney.
Chelsea's an attorney.
So we're not
going to
get Chelsea up this way.
We are not getting them,
Yeah.
Gabriel loves to play golf.
Oh, really?
All year round. And
oh,
he loves to be in a softball league. And it's a nice one. I like the seasons, and I like to be the bitter cold, and I like to be... that fall feeling, you walk out and
get that in Miami.
you don't get that.
Yeah.
You don't get that.
Yeah. And it's not Red Sox Nation,
It is so
It's
not
the
Red
Miami
Sox
Marlins, the Terrapins. What do we, what
it's
is
the,
that?
It There's is the no, Miami Marlins,
It's kind of Miami Vice. You don't have Red Sox Nation down
no,
there.
No, you don't.
No. There we go.
No. And Aaron Alexander, the big boys are, who knows? They're in the city. They're trying to make a living, barely. And doing wonderful things, Alexander is working with his friend Todd, and Aaron is trying to be gainfully employed, doing some library science or law clerking stuff. Mm-hmm. I think they're trying to prolong post-college graduation for as long as possible.
And this could be a topic for discussion. When you say prolong, it makes me think of adolescence in modern times. From 18 or whenever, whenever adolescence starts prior to that, some folks into their 30s, what's up with that?
I think part of it is that everything happens later in life. When we lived in Park Slope as younger couple.
And you were the cutting edge there. You guys started the cutting edge of cutting edge
we
in
lived
Park
in an
Slope.
Area that was
and
a little
iffy. Now,
and
now
it's like, you it's know, really, boy, you can rent a brownstone in that
yeah,
area.
Yeah.
So we lived in Park Slope in the early to mid 80s, gosh, that's true. And we were so young to have children. We were 24, 25, Susan and I. And people were 36 having their first child. And we were thinking, what's everybody doing? Why is everybody so old? So what we've seen over the past generation, certainly baby boomers and then certainly millennials for sure, everything happens later. And because you take a gap year. And then you do your degree, and then you think about maybe an MBA, but first you want to travel. And then you do an internship before you get a job. And then, so things
out
are
of necessity.
sometimes, but it's all prolonged in the multiplicity of experiences, I guess, adds to resume, and also adds to life. And I've said this before, when we went to college, what's your major? What are you going to do with that?
Right.
That was the question.
Exactly.
We don't ask. God forbid you're going to ask now. Yeah. I say, oh, do you have a major? I said, oh, how good. That's great. They say, oh, I have a triple major. Latin. Kinesthetics and kinesiology and who knows.
That would be good. If anybody out there has that combination, please call us because we want to talk with you. In fact, we'd like to counsel you.
Yes.
I mean that's an array.
But I think it all happens later. One reason that B'nai Mitzvah. Bar Bat Mitzvah celebrations, especially in the 70s, 80s, even 90s, were a little bit out of control, I think, is because Jewish parents knew that they may not be able to control or make their children's weddings the way they wanted to, but that Bar Bat Mitzvah, boy, they could do anything they wanted.
Wow.
And so there was that sense of, we got it. Because kids marry later.
Yeah.
So I think everything happens later. I think it is prolonging adolescence.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny. There's a certain rock and roll band here in Larchmont, and this will be a little test to see who's out there watching and getting back to us. The band Sway. Do you know Sway?
Okay. I'm sorry to say I don't.
Okay. I'm sorry. But Ted Utz on the bass guitar. Andy Helfinger. brother of Tommy, on the lead guitar. Lou Young of News 2. Lou's the lead vocal.
Wait, is Andy Helfinger Andy who grew up in Larchmont?
Yeah. And then Mike on the keyboards. I'm forgetting Mike's last name. And then there's a percussion guy. These guys, okay, here it comes. These guys are 55 going on 18.
Right.
Okay. They are living a dream. They all are doing some stellar things professionally, but, you know, it's kind of like they started out, I think it was Andy the Spark, playing, you know, in somebody's garage, just like way back when, but still they're going into their 50s, and they just couldn't be having, you know, more fun. And they're really good. They're good. They're a good group. I mean, and they'll tell you that.
So part of it is that you want to preserve youth. Part of it is that growing old, I mean, you know, our society fights against growing old all the time. I was on a lovely TV show, actually. What's today?
Hold on, you're on a lovely.
Thursday.
Hold on. You're on a lovely TV show right now.
I am on such a lovely TV show.
Oh my goodness.
This is a different story. I was on a lovely TV show.
Here we are. Cesar.
Oh, here we go. Look at this.
It's a little, you know, a little nondescript compared to what you often have on that plate, you know?
You know what? They didn't tell them it was for me.
Thank you so much. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Well, let us break bread.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam HaMotzi Lechem Min HaAretz Butzei Yonai, God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth.
Thanks be to God for the bread of life and the spirit we share. Amen. I'm going to
partake.
Pan.
Companionship. Mm.
At the heart of companionship.
I learned such things from this man.
And vice versa.
So the story is that I'm on this TV show because this wonderful guy, Bobby Sheehan, who's a filmmaker here in Washington, really in the city.
Can we get the name of the TV show?
Bobby Sheehan.
Is it 60 Minutes? No.
You know what? I'm embarrassed. I'll tell you in a minute if I can dredge it up. But Bobby did this project called Mortal, which was filming all kinds of people in the throes of either losing someone or dealing with death or considering death or battling death or thinking about the afterlife. So it was a wonderful film, and it's just actually being screened now around the country. And he said there's a couple of the people that he met as a result who, these two women, both psychologists, lovely, and they have a show on Hope. I think it's called Bridge of Hope or something like that. And it's in New York City on cable stations and maybe in further on I don't remember what it is, but it's on cable stations.
We need some annotation to these wonderful things.
I mean, we do.
Bobby Sheehan. Okay.
Bobby Sheehan, yep.
And the film is Mortal.
Mortal's great. And
not to be confused with Humans on Broadway.
No.
And then these two gals who have a show, it's on a cable,
show.
On Hope. So, Hope of what? Hope what?
It's maybe Bridge to Hope, Hope Line, Hope Link. It's lovely. And they've done 84, 85 shows. And it was all started as a result of this compassionate friends group of people dealing with death and loss and tragic loss. So I'm on with these two wonderful monks, Koshin and Shodo. Remember their names? They were great. And one of them wrote a book.
Thelonious Monk? Was he there?
Thelonious Monk. He's going back to the metaphor of jazz.
Yeah.
No, but the wild thing was this, that in the same way that, you know, birth and death, the rabbis teach, border one another. There's a thin veil separating the two. They were talking about the experience of the way we have a birth doula. A birth doula would be a woman, usually, helping somebody go from, you know, not having a child to having a child and helping the birth and et cetera, almost like a midwife. They have death doulas. I thought, that is so wild. What is that? And that's, of course, transitioning, helping somebody transition from this world, as they said, to the next. And there was this very interesting sense of that these two psychologists were so into, and it was a great show on, you know, on loss. But it just struck me. Lovely, lovely ladies, both of whom clearly, you know, had some work done.
What does that mean? Had some work done.
What does that mean? What's that code for? Anyone want to shout that out? So they had some plastic surgery and some, you know, sort of work on themselves, and they were both, whatever they were, mid-50s, and it was a mother and daughter team. mid-50s and, you know, or you know, and 80 or 78 or something. But they were dealing with death and loss, and yet they wanted to look young. And it was this juxtaposition. It was almost an irony to me. And I think that's the tendency in our society. It's you want to look young. You want to present as, I sort of like my gray hair.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I wonder, and this would be an interesting study survey. I mean, any topic for us could be a study and survey, it seems. But I wonder what you just said, how much that holds true. I mean, I'm wondering and thinking that more and more, you know, as folks kind of move into the middle age, there are some moments when they indeed want to look young. However, you know, there's mortality, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, Bill Sheehan, Bruce, whatever his name is.
Bobby Sheehan.
Bobby Sheehan, you know, the reckoning of that topic. You know, we're all mortal. Yeah. I mean, Genesis 3:19, from dust we come, to dust we return.
Yeah.
You know, we can't, you know, prolong. I mean, now there's some science steps and whatever, you know. The Time magazine article has a picture of a baby, you know, somewhat within the past 6 months. And the caption there, right over the beautiful baby's face, is, will she live to be 142?
You know, oh, my God.
You know, I mean, is that what we're saying, thinking, wondering, hoping for? I'd like to think that here's the mortality about us. I think more and more aging baby boomers are saying, especially because they're caring for aging loved ones, okay? It's like, you know, don't prolong it for me.
Yeah.
I mean, Peter Townsend from The Who, another rock and roll group. We got a soundtrack for this show.
We do have. Yeah.
Peter Townsend, I hope I die before I get old, you know? Yeah. So I mean, even I and you, I'll talk first, or you can talk too, in terms of, are we trying to look young, be young, feel young? You know, you just did a shout out for your gray hair, you know? And by the way, if people haven't noticed, I've begun to lose hair. No way. Yeah, way. Okay? I accept it. You know, do you see me coming on set with a toupee?
No.
I accept it. I accept it.
No.
That's me. A little bit from me, I'll share you now. Talk among yourselves.
Yeah.
Okay? What would you say to that? Again, the point being, I think more and more people are accepting and kind of going, even maybe going with grace.
Yeah. Well, I think
into aging.
And I think that's exactly it. We want to go from, aging to saging. Right, so we want to grow old.
Oh, that's wonderfully put.
With wisdom, and with the ability to understand that the more life experience you have, the more you have to share with those around you, and to gift the generations that are up and coming with your life wisdom.
You know, and how about this? Here's a little biblical note. Okay, it's not Tanakh, it's not Torah, but the Psalms, Psalm 90. Okay. You know, what is it? A day is, you know, a day in our lives, you know, like a thousand.
Like a shadow that passes in the night, like a watch in the night.
I mean, kind of a thousand ages gone are like, you know, the night.
Right.
You know, as
a watch in the night. It says,
a watch in the night.
Yep.
But then further on in that psalm, like, you know, about 20,
teach us to number our days
with a wise heart.
That we may grow wise in heart.
With a wise heart.
Yes.
Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah, that's beautiful.
I mean, I think when you go from this note of, you know, aging to saging, did I hear that?
Yeah, that's
I'm
right.
I'm going to write down what the rabbi
that's
says.
Right.
That's a good one.
That's good. You
that's
see?
A good one. And we brought the psalm in too.
Sunday sermon.
Amen.
Sunday sermon.
Amen. Amen.
So as we're sitting here, you know, contemplating old age and growing old together.
Are we doing that? Is that what we're doing?
We're contemplating the nature of life, I think. We live in such, boy, that Chinese fortune cookie, you should live in interesting times.
No, no.
You couldn't make this up.
No, no.
It's just.
Oh my God. And here we are. Today is the day, June 23rd. Let's start at a distance and then come close.
Go ahead.
At a distance. As we're speaking, and we're 6 hours difference between us and Britain, so they're, you know, they're probably, that makes it like 2:30 p.m.
Right.
How many people have voted in Britain today? And for what? That
Brexit,
whole EU.
Yeah.
the EU thing, and it looks like, I mean, the odds are pretty close. Mike, do we have a return on the votes in London yet?
They said it was 48 to 42. Oh, 48 remain, 42 leave.
Oh, my gosh. What to make of that?
Yeah.
I think, you know, people like David Cameron have been eloquent in terms of the operative word being together.
Yeah.
Together. You know, obviously, here's the monetary fiduciary. But what about, you know, matters of climate change? What about matters of immigration? What about, I mean, here we have the antecedents of NATO, of post-war Europe. I mean, you know, there was consolidation and connection.
Yes, yes,
okay.
So what's the parallel? How could you see? I don't think there is a parallel to America. Somebody said, oh, it'd be like if Texas seceded from the Union and decided to do their own government and their own. I'm not sure that's really a parallel.
That's a very interesting question. I don't know. I don't know. Secession
but
is an issue, and does it correlate to what we're talking about?
Yeah. And just the very notion that, you know, the EU, as we call it, the European Union, would not be a union.
Yeah.
And would all of a sudden be almost, there would almost be like, you know, it would be a competitive field. Is that what we're talking about? Are we back to, you know, the idea of a European Union as is a wonderful sense of shared communal responsibility for the welfare of all its citizens.
You know, and it's a very good point, because I wonder if, you know, here's Britain, here's London, here's the antecedents, you know, are that of the empire, you know, there's the sun doesn't set on the empire. But there was this moment in modern times, way past post-war,
yes,
1994 to be exact, when the EU came together.
That's right.
I think in the time since then, and gosh, that's been a number of years. I mean, in the time since then, here comes the elements of Greece and Southern Europe and, you know, stuff that the low man, person, woman on the totem pole is looking like they're going under, as in underwater. And so the cooperative in that and of that is lost,
right?
You know, and it's like, okay, it's almost like, is it attrition or is it triage? If somebody else is going down, it ain't going to be us.
What's my responsibility to that?
Yet, are we not, to quote from Martin Luther King, part of, you know, a seamless garment? I mean, is it there not an interconnectability?
You would hope.
Something there affects us here.
You would hope.
You
would hope. And just in case you thought that it was just the EU that was dealing with its own challenge about the future, here we go. America. We have a sit-in on the House floor.
Right, last night.
So if there's a theme here, it's
about... And I guess it's still going on. Could we go to that on-site location?
Yeah, Nancy Pelosi was talking the last time I saw.
Okay, they were Cory Booker, Nancy. I think they're playing cards. I think they're you're cross-legged.
They actually did have pizza delivered early in the morning, I heard. Yeah.
Here we go.
So what's so compelling about this is you got John Lewis at the front.
I should say it's the House, not the Senate.
So yes, the House. That's right. So John Lewis, great civil rights leader, who was on the dais with the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Yeah,
you know, as
20-something guy.
And what did they sing on the House floor? We shall pass a bill someday. We shall pass a bill. So think about, to me, what's so compelling is that there is a correlation. Of course, there's a correlation. Sorry, the correlation is that we want to preserve human dignity and human freedom at all costs. And if we can do that with civil protest, the challenge here is we have not some citizens protesting a governmental stand. We have the government protesting the government.
Well, but let's tease that out a bit more. I mean, we have Democrats, you know, finally stepping up. I mean, they lost a majority how many years ago, and they're beholden to the Republicans in the House and in the Senate. And we mentioned 1994, poignant year, founding of the EU. 1994, what does it mean in terms of guns in America? That was the year that
was
the
William on March, you
know? No, that was the year of the assault weapons ban.
Oh my gosh.
It was put in place. It was invoked. It was a bill that was to be in effect for 10 years. 10 years came and went without it being reinstituted. So we get to 2004, after Columbine, on the heels of Newtown, on comes San Bernardino.
Yeah.
Are these names familiar? Yeah. And then most recently, Orlando. And nothing is done. Congress has been silent. And you know what? the silence is killing us in this country. You know, we can't do anything in that House, it seems, or the Senate, insofar as taking legislative action against the trafficking of guns, background checks, and assault weapons. Yeah. Who needs an assault weapon? Right. Here's the vehemence. I know I'm not alone.
No.
You know, why and how do average citizens need automatic weapons, AK-15s, you know, that pull the trigger and 13 rounds automatically
come out.
And then we have even people in defense of that, and even some mockery. There's an auto dealer in New Hampshire this past weekend that said, for the next four new cars, everyone who purchased one gets an AK-15.
Oh my God!
From what is it? You know, Sharpshooter Wayne.
Oh my gosh!
You know, is that awesome or horrendous?
Oh my God!
So not only is there a silence in the Congress, and here comes the Democrats. You know, calling for a vote.
Yeah.
The Republicans have closed the door on the vote.
Yeah.
Not only is there silence there, but elsewhere. Here we have Wayne LaPierre of the NRA. You know, talking about the Second Amendment, you know, that's being violated because we can't bar, you know, and call to arms literally on that. We have Donald Trump saying, what would have stopped San Bernardino?
If we all had arms.
You know, Jerry Falwell Jr., the president of Liberty College in January of this year, stands before the student body and says, right now, in my back pocket, I have a 25 millimeter pistol, and you should have one too. And that would have stopped the San Bernardino killings. A college president saying that.
Yeah.
You know, if I were a congressperson, and you too, we would be, you know, would we not, you know, calling for the legislation and taking action to at least have it aired, discussed, you know, considered. The Republicans are closing the door on that.
Morning Joe this morning, just a quick highlight, he's talking to some Cole, his name is Cole, he's a congressman. And he said, and Joe Scarborough, who was a VAC congressman,
from the panhandle in Florida, Tallahassee,
right. So very, very, very distressed with this guy. No, Joe Scarborough's a Republican, and he's talking to this Republican congressman, who's basically saying, you know, it's a publicity stunt. What these Democrats are doing, it's not the way you get things done. There was a vote. There was a vote that didn't really pass, didn't get through. So he's basically, and then they get to the no-fly list. And basically this congressman said, well, the no-fly list is impossible to fix. You know, there are some politicians that are on it. So that's a no discussion point. And so Joe Scarborough basically laid into him and said, so because something is broken, you don't fix it because it's too broken? Because what's your rationale? What are you even saying? What are you talking about? And why is this a publicity stunt if the Democrats are trying to push in a vote? They're not putting. They want to discuss. They want open dialogue on the floor, and I think it just shows you this should transcend party lines.
Indeed.
This should transcend. It's a sad day when, in fact, the gun lobby this is not the Wild West. We don't live in this a day and age. When, you know, gun-toting civilians have to make sure that they protect themselves and their families against marauding who knows who.
And let me try something else here, because, you know, I've wondered about this, and there have been a few people who have even voiced this question. And I'll admit it's radical. It's really anti-constitutional, that is to say, you know, the amendments to the Constitution, and by that, that should get attention, but it's with regard to the Second Amendment. That was founded and established in a day and time when, you know, we were a colony and on our way to becoming a nation, and we had, you know, we were in occupied territory in the eyes of Britain and King George, who's marvelously played in the play Hamilton. But you know, that was instituted because of the, you know, the government from, you know, across the seas, and their army, you know, taking over, you know, our houses,
right,
our houses of worship, bivouacking themselves, if that's a word. You know, they house themselves, they push people out. They do the stuff that oppressors do in occupied lands and territory.
The times have changed.
Indeed.
Not the legislation changed.
Well, that's the point. That's the point. And I'm saying this, you know, Lin-Manuel, you know, the creator of Hamilton, who plays, you know, Hamilton himself on stage, marvelous job, don't you think? But, you know, this wasn't addressed in the play itself, but is that not a concern? We have the NRA and so many people hearkening back to the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms. Why and how did that come to be? And is that the case now?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And what of a culture that wants to arm itself to the teeth? There are more guns in America, to multiple extensions, than there are people in America. You know, there is someone shot, you know, with frequency that could be, you know, around every 30 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, there are incidents and mass killings that have been numerous. 19 mass killings per year since 1994.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, my gosh. What will it take? You know, I mean, here are those people on the floor of the House right now sitting down doing what they're doing just to get some discussion among legislators, hopefully to pass something to stop it.
And it looked like, based on a national poll, was it, somebody said 90%, I'm not sure if it's 90%, but it's pretty high, of the American, general population would like to see some sensible gun legislation. The most compelling response to me, I mean, there are a lot of compelling responses, but the great Lin-Manuel Miranda, you know, of Hamilton fame, when he accepted his first Tony last Sunday night, and it was the day
actually,
after.
Actually, his second Tony.
Yeah. Was it the second Tony?
He got the Tony for In the Heights?
No. I meant the first Tony that night.
Oh, yeah.
When he got up, he had written a sonnet for his wife and daughter, but what he really wrote was a response to Orlando and to gun violence.
Yeah.
And the key line there was?
Love is love,
you know, that shall not be, you know, that cannot be killed, you know, or set aside, you know, right. And we should embrace one another with pride. And it's just so compelling.
You know, I used that in the sermon at the Larchmont Avenue
Church. I used it Friday night.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, we should exchange and really put them on the link or whatever for LMC-TV.
Yeah.
Awesome stuff.
No, it's tough because we are clergy. So we are spiritual leaders. And we live with the reality of life out there. And what, as Abraham Joshua Heschel said so poignantly, you cannot separate, you cannot, what did he say? He said, petrify, the goal is, I'm trying to remember the exact phrase. What he meant by it was that what happens in the house of worship is meant to be translated into the street. And so as we deal with just the craziness of gun violence, mass shootings, killings, even the rhetoric between political candidates, you know, she's a liar. She's a
crooked.
Really?
Crooked.
Really?
Crooked hole.
Really? This is the model? In my life, there are times when a moral voice for beyond faith, how about reason, but a moral voice for unity of purpose and a sense of shared common humanity.
Yeah.
It's so important for us.
Yeah, there's another notation from the sermon on Sunday, and I wouldn't be surprised if you came across this as well, was from the surgeon in the emergency room at the Orlando Regional Hospital.
This was
a fellow whose last name escapes me. I mean, I think it's Jonas. This is an ER doc who came to work. Mind you, the shootings began at the Pulse nightclub, gay nightclub in Orlando, which really, to hear and know about that club, much like Stonewall in previous years, 1973 New York, much like the upstairs, or Stonewall was 1969, much like the upstairs club in New Orleans in 1973, the scenes of mass killings of gays. Here came the Pulse nightclub incident on the early morning of June 12th, Sunday, and so here came into work this ER doc, and he was just on the job, on his feet, tending, responding, and at the end of the day, there's a Facebook tweet posting in which he said, at the end of the day, you know, I took off my scrubs, I had, you know, all that surgeons wear. I'm paraphrasing now. And, you know, that included the booties, those little things they put over
their
shoes. And he took them off. And he had just a week before bought a new pair of sneakers, okay, running shoes. And he posted a picture of those shoes. The fiber of the shoes was just drenched with the blood. And he said, of 54 individuals.
Yep.
I didn't know if that blood was black or white or Hispanic or straight or gay. These were 54 precious individuals.
Yeah.
I will never forget, you know, the tragedy, which was, you know, the most painful, awful. But also, you know, he said in those moments were, you know, for me, as he witnessed, painful, awful. They were also the best and the greatest because of the care, the compassion, the diligence with which ER people, nurses, techs, police, rescue workers came. He said, I will, you know, wear those shoes every day until the last of all of these patients leaves the hospital.
Wow.
And then when that, because there is work to be done and more work to be done, I will keep them in my office and look at them every day. I will never forget. There is more work to be done.
Oh my God.
The work of love.
You
know, the acceptance, the understanding, the care, the compassion, to love one another as Leviticus in Torah, as Jesus calls us to. And that is the calling, that is the work.
That's why we're here.
Indeed.
That is why we're here. To save a single life is to save the world entire. To lose a single life or to destroy a single life is to destroy a world entire, says the Talmud. Mm. And so this is 50 worlds that were lost in Orlando. It's a tough time. It's a heavy time. It's also a wonderful time because our goal and our job is to celebrate hope. Is in the midst of despair, as Elie Wiesel said. You know, Voltaire said, "When despair becomes a duty, death is the only choice." And Wiesel said, "Not true for Jews," and I would say, "Not true for all of us."
Voltaire said that.
Yep.
I think that's a historic moment. I don't think we've ever quoted Voltaire on this.
There you go. I can only quote it because Wiesel did in To Be a Jew.
And then we've gotten into philosophers. Well, you know, we've kind of moved to theologians and clerics. I mean, I think of Pascal, but you know. Voltaire, first for Voltaire.
We are up there.
Really?
Okay?
Really.
And so Wiesel said, not true for Jews, and I would say not true for Jews and Christians. When death becomes a duty and despair is blah, 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 we create new hope. So the goal is to create hope. The goal is in the face of this, you know, what do we do? We reach out.
Yeah.
We celebrate life.
Yeah.
You know, we embrace.
Yeah.
You know, because it's in the betweenness. That's where God's presence is. That's what it's about.
Well, you know, I don't want to miss, you know, in the betweenness, and we're blessed by the resources of LMC-TV that allow us to connect and share with all of you out there. I just want to do a shout out for LMC-TV because along the lines of the Orlando shooting, for those of you who are regulars watching LMC-TV, And we think and hope that includes watching the Reverend and the Rabbi. This past week, we got an email from Eric Lewis, who noted that over the past week on LMC-TV, there were scheduled viewings of a very special film documentary entitled Puzzles, which is the name of the gay nightclub in Bedford, Mass.
Yep.
That in 2006 was the site of a mass killing of someone who was identified, self-identified as a neo-Nazi, who took weapons, you know, both, you know, mortal, manual, that is to say knives as well as guns, and attacked there in that club. And so LMC-TV, quick on the heels of June 12th in Orlando, posted the showing of this. And you can go to the website and you can see it, and we invite and urge you to do that. I think what LMC-TV has done is, you know, here, with, thanks for what we're able to do, stimulated, you know, and engaged some discussion and witness, and a resource. Resources have been profound. Glad to be a part of them as we are talking with you. But also, please, please take a look at that film about that 2006 incident in Bedford. Yeah. Does history repeat itself? You know, I as the surgeon in Orlando has noted, there is more work to be done. And even, you know, President Obama and Vice President Biden acknowledged that while our hearts are aching and saddened, I think I heard the president say these words, this won't be the last.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
We will be witness to more up ahead.
Yeah.
What of that, and what can we do to stop, you know, the violence, the madness, insofar as, you know, our responses of community and compassion and love for one another.
Yeah.
So shout out to LMC on the TV on that. Eric Lewis, you know, and there's a triumvirate. I mean, Eric Lewis, Matt Sullivan, Dina Schumacher, you know, and a wonderful staff and host of very able people who, in many ways, at the beginning of LMC-TV, were sparked by the wonderful gifts of our brother and dear friend, Mike Charles.
Charles, that's right.
Shout out to Mike and shout out to Lake. Some of us had the opportunity to be at the awards night not too long ago up here at the VFW spot, and along with some wonderful accolades and awards for the best shows. The local live show is kind of experiencing its anniversary.
Yes.
And what a finger on the pulse. What a great medium and vehicle for and in this community. I can't say enough about that. So again, shouts to LMC-TV. You go, guys. I mean, Matt, Dina, Eric, you know, thanks to Mike. One of my favorite interviewers is Alice Bloom. You know, you've got Terry Gross, you got Charlie Rose, you got Rachel Maddow, but Alice Bloom
is good.
She's in the top three. I mean, and right here, down home. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, what LMC-TV represents
is
the microcosm. It's the answer to what Reverend Bill's challenge is for us. How do you combat this isolationism, this intolerance, you know, this hate? You combat it by building bridges, by reaching out, by galvanizing community, by creating community.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what LMC-TV does. Yeah. That's what, you know, we try to do in the work we do every day.
Yeah, yeah.
We can't do it alone. We can't do it alone.
No. So listen, I'm looking at this omelet.
You know, I got so into our conversation.
Jeffrey, you have to eat, I'm telling you. Okay? The yellow shirt matches the eggs, but eggs need to be in the body. Come on, work with me.
I was so taken by the conversation. And
me too.
So, you know, so it's summertime. It's hitting us now. It's summertime. And, you know, summer always brings that sort of downtime. What happens at the church on summertime? I mean, you know, we go low-key-ish.
Yeah.
We have a great institution that Rabbi Jack Stern, the great rabbi, may his memory be for blessing of Westchester Reformed Temple, helped institute in the area, which is many congregations have lay-led services on Shabbat.
Wow.
So Friday night will be lay-led by a lay sort of rabbi
and where
a
are
lay
you? Do you...
sort of cantor. I do not step foot in the Bima. I work during the week.
Are you there in the sanctuary?
I am not in the sanctuary.
Goodness.
I do not go to services.
For how many weeks does this happen?
Like, it's off and on. It'll be, you know, I'll stop in, but it'll be most of the summer.
Oh my gosh. So I just want to
like
say
eight
that
weeks.
For the non-Jewish brothers and sisters out there among us who are clergy, it's and our parishioners and members, you might oh my gosh, listen to this.
And why, why do we do this?
Why am I envious all of a sudden?
Why do we do this? For, I mean, I'm there during the week and we're working and we allow other folks to lead our Chevrat Torah on Shabbat morning.
Yeah, yeah.
So other people are teaching. Why? What does this say? It's my teacher, Rabbi Larry Kushner's great truth. Jews should treat rabbis more like Jews. Rabbis should treat Jews more like rabbis.
That's
and
wonderful.
So, and
that's
so the
wonderful.
Goal the goal here is
that's
the
wonderful.
Goal here is that I don't own the pulpit, nor do I own what's said from it, nor do I own the ability or the gift of being able to lead others in worship.
Yeah, yeah.
And so we work with, and we have trainings, and you know, Arbitral
yeah.
Committee, and
yeah.
Cantor Mendelsohn did a great training session, and so you know, it's really a nice opportunity. First of all, it's great downtime for us. We're pretty intense the entire sort
no,
of academic
not
year.
You.
Me, not me. But it's a great sense, and it enables us to recharge, to renew, to rethink, you know,
right.
and to do, and so it's a really wonderful,
yeah,
wonderful
yeah.
gift.
That sounds great.
And it also lets, you know, six or seven or eight pairs of people to say, wow, this service leading stuff, this is a challenge, I'll tell you right now.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, say more about what that means, because I think translating that as a clergy person myself, it's to say, okay, well, you know, get a load of that. It
yeah.
really,
yeah.
we don't just, as some people might say to ministers, a priest on occasion, and that is, could I have some water too, Cesar?
I'll take another one, thanks, sir.
You know, it's like, I don't know if rabbis get this line, but for some reason with me, what people will say, I just want to finish this, hold on a second.
Okay,
big line here, big line before we get a walk on. It's to say, you got a great job working only 20 minutes one day a week, as in one Sunday. So it's kind of like, ooh, not true. There we go.
Oh my God.
We got something to say here.
Look at this, we getting a walk on, but it's a book giveaway.
It's a book
giveaway.
Oh my gosh.
Look at this.
There aren't very many of these out there.
Look at this.
My friend owns the publishing company, and I told him to send me a couple
Look
of
these.
Look at this. Wow, wow.
You know,
look at this.
What is this?
You
look
can
at
get
this.
Enough for the whole congregation.
L'dor v'dor, from generation
there
to generation, a keepsake coloring book.
Oh, yes. My gosh.
You'll love it. Enjoy it.
You're great.
Yeah, I think we need to have an introduction here. People are going to be wondering.
From Car Ben.
Yeah, yeah,
look
yeah.
Look at this.
Do you want to introduce?
Introduce whom?
You, my friend.
Me?
Yeah, yeah. Jeffrey,
look
why don't you?
Look at this.
People out there, whoever doesn't know this dear gentleman, please listen closely.
Well, wait, where did you get the?
My friend owns the company.
You want to introduce
the
yourself?
My name is Sid Albert.
Sid Albert.
Former
Sid.
Trustee at Village of Mamaroneck and a good friend of the rabbi.
Sid is a sweetheart.
Okay.
Sid is an honorary member of Larchmont Temple.
We do the best we can in order to supply them with update things as far as the Jewish community.
There we go. There we go.
Sid is my Jewish source.
Sid.
Boychik, enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you.
There we go.
Very cool.
Thank you, Sid.
Very
you, Sid.
Cool. Very
there
cool.
We go.
Whenever
there we
you
go.
Can give away books, that I mean, that's a gift.
We must have a Yiddish word for that.
That's a gift. That's so cool.
Great, great, great.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Pretty sweet.
Yeah,
pretty
really
sweet.
Nice.
So,
yeah.
You know, we don't have time for, there's two other people out there. One of their names, Hillary, Donald, that we don't have time for them.
But,
okay. Sid, could you talk to that big guy with the orange hair?
Hillary?
Yeah, it's okay. Let's keep going. Here we go.
So, so we have the gift of summer, which really enables us to renew. But all of us, I think, need that renewal. You're doing a four-day road trip.
Yeah.
Any other big summer plans?
We're kind of working them out. We've got moving parts in our
I hear
family.
You.
Yeah,
I hear
yeah,
you.
Yeah. So
no, believe me.
There's a period of 10 days where we all will be in Larchmont together. And that is to say, you know, my wife Julie, beloved son Graham, and Mari. And so we're kind of determining what we're going to do all together.
Great.
Okay.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's
yeah.
Great.
Yeah, yeah. So we'll stay tuned. But how about you? Now, are you going to get up to Red Sox Nation? I know you got the MLP viewing plan, and you can at the ready.
MLP plan. Yeah. We will. I'm going to go visit. The folks. You know, the family, the Paul family, up in New Hampshire for a few days.
Say hello to Leona.
Early August to Leona.
God bless you.
My brother-in-law, David and Maddie's lake house, which would be great with all the cousins. I'll try to take, you know,
Sophie and Tyler, and hopefully Aaron and Alexander can get away.
How about Bella? Who's going to take care of Bella?
You know what? I will take Bella with us because you can't leave Bella.
No, no, no.
What are you going to say? Leave her the number and say if you get, you know, please. You know, you got to take Bella. Bella's probably, you know.
Exactly, exactly.
And so we'll do that. I'm going to go visit Gabe and Chels probably for 5 or 6 days in August. You know, why not? Who doesn't? Who wouldn't want to go to Miami in August?
Who wouldn't?
So that's what I'll do. But it's just good downtime. It's time to read, to renew, to reflect. To think about the coming year.
Yeah.
You know, we have an awesome clergy team.
You really do.
And we've been meeting on High Holy Days already. So we're already in the middle of High Holy Day planning. So it's the great gift for me of working in a congregation which enables me to step back a little bit and to let others step in.
Yeah. Well, I'm happy to hear that. That sounds great. You know, how are we doing? Mike gives us the 4 minutes time.
Okay. I'm gonna share one book I am reading because I think about the High Holy Days, and this is a preview. So all of you, thousands of listeners who are out there and watching, you know, what am I thinking about the High Holy Days? I don't know what sermon it's gonna be. I don't know if it's gonna be Erev Rosh Hashanah. Where actually Rabbi Miller and I may share in giving a sermon together, or it may be Rosh Hashanah Day or Yom Kippur Day. But one of the sermons I'm hoping to give, thinking about the nature of religion and the nature of Judaism, but really Judaism, Christianity, Islam, major religions, monotheistic religions, and what happens when you put God first. Because we always think, you know, God's at the center. So this is a great book that I'm about a third of the way through, but I know it's a great book because I read the end. But this is Rabbi Doniel Hartman. Who's Hartman? Hartman's father was David Hartman, founder of the Hartman Institute, which is one of the unique trans-denominational houses or sort of institutes for study and thought. It brings together rabbis from America, but really around the world, Orthodox, conservative, reform. And what Hartman's contention is we have to save religion from itself. Because there are impulses in religion which if you sort of are out of whack, or if you take them for what they are, you will not only get the wrong impression, but you will put God first in a way that denigrates human beings and tarnishes the image of God within us in the process. Case in point, Abraham.
Right.
Abraham's test at the binding of Isaac. Abraham's going to bind Isaac. Abraham says, you know, God says, sacrifice your son, your only one, the one you love, you know, on the mountain that I show you. And Abraham says, here I am, and goes and does it. Hartman says, no, that's not the kind of faith that God intends. Abraham didn't pass the test. And so there's a, like Kierkegaard said, we got Voltaire, we get Kierkegaard.
Kierkegaard has some great stuff on this. Yeah. You know, Fear and Trembling Unto Death.
Fear and Trembling, yeah.
Right. Yeah. There's a book by Soren Kierkegaard, Scandinavian theologian. But on that whole, you know, Abraham sacrifice of Isaac in the Hebrew, oh my gosh, I'm citing Hebrew
go
for
ahead,
you.
Go for it.
The Akedah, the binding.
The binding of Isaac, Akedah, Akedah Yitzchak. Bottom line is, perhaps we should put God second. Perhaps we should put people first. Perhaps we should understand how to recalibrate our faith in a way that integrates it into a world that has a balance. And so I will tell you where it goes, but it's a very exciting exploration, and I couldn't do it if my, you know, if this summertime was not in existence.
Now, let me guess, because I mean, this really cuts across and is imbued in our traditions. You know, mine, Christian, Protestant, yours, Reform Judaism.
Yes.
Ah, there's the word, reform.
Reform.
This is a reformed expression and tradition. This is not Orthodox. This is not conservative.
This guy's a modern Orthodox rabbi.
Oh, my gosh.
He's saying my folks blow it.
That's revolutionary.
That ultra-Orthodox blow it. That they don't get it. That any religion, any faith, when you think faith is first, you can fly planes into buildings, you can shoot people in markets and squares, but this is not what God intends, nor what religion intends. And so he has a system, he calls it religion's autoimmune disease. And that's what we're prone to when we put God first. And so we have to recalibrate and write a new prescription for a religion that puts God second. More to come.
My friend.
More to come.
You get a book, by
Mordecai,
the way.
More to come. And I actually have, you know, my other, you know, dark money, you know, about one of the issues, problems with American politics. Not enough time to talk about that, but under the rubric of more to come.
Next time.
More to come. Next and we're going to be glad to do that. It looks like September, because this is like a summer farewell. Am I right, Mike? Blake?
Could be. We can sneak one in August. We'll see.
What we would urge you to do is go to LMC-TV, click on, watch that film, Puzzles, as well as click on the show's program, go down to Reverend and the Rabbi, and binge. Binge on the Reverend and the Rabbi until we see you in September.
And
God bless.
Have eggs while you do.
There you go. Take care, my brother.
Be well, my friend.